Good morning.
Good morning, Devin.
Oh, we can do a little better than that. I know it's the third panel. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. I'm David Eisner. I'm CEO of Repair the World, which is a young Jewish service organization. Last year, Repair the World engaged about over 20,000 Jewish young adults and doing service, meaningful service activities, mostly in inner cities. As you heard, I've also toiled in national service for a while, serving for 5 years as CEO of the national, the Corporation for National and Community Service, where my boss was Alan Solomon and John Bridgeland, who was in the previous panel. Today we've got a big job with this panel. We're going to try to do a whole bunch over the next 50 minutes or so. The role that we have is to talk about volunteering internationally from a faith-based perspective. You've heard a lot this morning about how important the service is. And we know that about 50% of those who volunteer in the United States and internationally do so through the faith-based perspective. And so we know that there needs to be very strong connections and engagement. As a way of, I'm going to introduce the panel in just a second, but as a way of teeing up this conversation, let's quickly look around the room. Here in America, about 25% of Americans volunteer. Will you raise your hand if you volunteer each year? Okay, so in this room, we're doing a whole lot better than America in general. Now, everybody keep your hands up. All right. Now, only keep your hand up if you volunteer primarily through a faith-based organization. Okay, so if you look around, you'll see that here in this room, which is the epicenter of America's service movement, we're not coming very close to that 50% number. Now, I know we shouldn't feel bad. I've been working in this space for a really long time, really since Harris Wofford was running AmeriCorps in the mid-90s. And we've never managed to build the kind of deep allyship between our volunteer movement, our national service movement, and the faith-based community movements in this country. It's one of the reasons I'm so grateful that we're celebrating the 10th anniversary of the Building Bridges Coalition. I think that they're making some real progress in building that kind of allyship. And it's one of the reasons I'm so grateful to have such a terrific panel to speak with. Beginning on my far right, Eduardo Vargas works with Susan Richley, who you heard from earlier. Eduardo is the deputy director for the Center of Faith-Based and Community Initiatives at USAID. Closest to me, James Lindsay, is the executive director of the Catholic Volunteer Network, and he can share a really close view on what faith-based volunteering looks like and feels like on the ground. And in the middle, Yasmin Shaheen McConnell is the alliance director for, which includes bringing in faith-based organizations, for the Service Year Alliance. And so she'll be able to draw together some of the ways in which our discussions touch on youth engagement and touch on the service, the national service movement. So we're going to do this less in presentation form and more as a discussion. I would love to start off, Jim, when you heard this whole morning of discussions, How does that connect to the kind of activities that you and your volunteers do on the ground for your organization?
I think it connects very well. I think our volunteers are much like any other volunteers. They just happen to be coming for more of a faith motivation, perhaps, than others. It's hard to say, but our programs themselves that are sponsoring our volunteers are all faith-based programs. We have about 200 member programs in the Catholic Volunteer Network. About 75% of them are sponsored by Catholic entities, with the other 25% from various other Christian traditions. And what I heard today resonated very well with our experience. Our programs are very holistic in that the volunteers, it's not only about the work that the volunteers do, but it's also about living in community and exploring their faith life. The one thing that I did wonder about, as I heard, is I hear continually from our programs that there's a struggle in terms of finding enough people to fill the roles of the slots and the positions that they have available. So I would be interested to know, like from the first two panels, if they've had similar struggles in terms of numbers. It seemed like things were going relatively well for them, and I think for us, that's not necessarily the case, so I would like to explore that a little bit more deeply. But as far as the experience of what I heard this morning, it's very comparable to what our volunteers are doing.
Well, that's actually a really good transition, Yasmin. I was going to ask you, when you think in terms of recruitment and you think in terms of organizations that bring faith-based volunteers into their work, and non-faith-based organizations that engage faith-based volunteers. Which kinds of organizations do you think can most benefit, and which kinds of initiatives most benefit from engaging volunteers that come from that perspective?
Sure. Thanks, David. I'm going to take 1 second to say Ramadan Kareem to anyone who's in the room. I would be remiss if I did not say that. Thank you for your fast, and I hope it's an easy one this year. I want to say quickly, from the perspective of someone who's sitting up here, thank you, who served in 2008 in a post 9/11 service air corps. It was called the Arab American Resource Corps. I am a proud AmeriCorps alum. I served alongside Arab Americans and Muslim Americans across the country in cities that had high density populations of Arab and Muslim Americans and immigrants. It was an exceptionally impactful year for me, both as an Arab American, but also as someone who was an American who wanted to figure out how to serve their country after 9/11. I've thought about that a lot in the last couple days, actually, and hearing us talk on stage has been interesting to think about the ways that we can engage, to your point, David, young people, both of faith and not of faith, but within faith organizations and faith traditions here in the United States. There's many different ways that we can do this. And as a millennial, I've actually seen a lot more integration amongst young people of faith and people who are considered a very buzzwordy thing, which is called the nuns here in America today, young people who don't have a faith affiliation. And we've seen a big mixture of people actually serving across different organizations and different cores from many different perspectives. So I want to start out first by acknowledging that, and acknowledging, too, that there is no one type of young person. We can come up and say that there are many different statistics about how often young people do volunteer, and we do volunteer at higher rates than generations past have been, but there is no single millennial. There's no one person that really embodies everything about our generation. So I would encourage us when we talk today to think about how we're getting young people involved in these organizations. To think about what draws us to them. Having an impact, actually, is one of the most critical things young people look for in purpose within their jobs and within what they do around in their day-to-day life, both in school and outside school. So I encourage organizations, both faith-based and non-faith-based, to address young people by bringing them in through that impact lens. What is the impact that you're making? Because young people of faith are looking to make an impact just like anyone else is. So that's the first major takeaway, I'd say. And the second one is actually a little bit self-critical of our own movement. One of the things that we haven't done very well in the past is to acknowledge the long tradition of faith-based organizations in the Service Year movement. And one of the things that we can do better in the future is to bring them in together with the rest of the Service Year movement, both domestically and internationally, and look at ourselves as if we're doing this together. One of the things I can't do is bring a lot of statistics, actually, about young people of faith serving within faith-based organizations and outside of them, because we haven't done a holistic job of measuring the movement very well. And so one thing I'd like us to think about on stage today, and if you come to our working session later, is how we can better do that together, to know that we are drawing in young people and people of all ages, from a faith perspective and a non-faith perspective, but making sure those organizations are integrated well into our movement.
Thank you. Eduardo, speaking of impact, looking from USAID's perspective and your department, where would you give an example or two of a really powerful engagement and partnership where the faith-based volunteers are playing sort of a driving role in bringing the impact?
Definitely. Well, first of all, good afternoon to everybody, and I just want to say thanks to the Building Bridges Partnership Coalition and Brookings for organizing this timely event. And to all of you for taking time out of your schedules to participate in this very timely convening, and specifically this panel. And it's quite an honor for me to be sitting here with Yasmin, with Jim, and David. Thank you for your service to the nation as well. Working at USAID, I think a lot of times people see a dissection between faith-based organizations and the government. And maybe we could talk about this a little bit later as the conversation evolves. But for USAID, working with faith-based organizations has been kind of one of the cornerstones of our history, right? Many of the relationships that we have with faith-based organizations transcend, actually, the creation of USAID in 1961. So two examples that I could think of, David, at this particular moment is one that I'm personally working on with our unaccompanied children in Central America in the Northern Triangle, in Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador. And many times, people have been wondering, how are we going to address this issue, so on and so forth, and, you know, the governments of these countries typically don't have the infrastructure to address it in the way that we here in the United States would want it addressed. Last November, and last month, actually, I was in Central America, and the first time I was there specifically researching this issue, I was astounded to find out that really faith-based organizations are taking the lead. And speaking as an individual, not as a government official, it was my impression that they were actually leading the cause. So you have Salesians International, you have Hermanas de María Auxiliadora, you have many Protestant churches leading this charge and actually giving guidance to government and social work agencies doing this. Now, what astounded me from this is when you see the impact that they've been having, you look and, one of the things that we always ask is, how big is your staff? And they say, well, our staff is 10 people, but the rest are volunteers. And these are all faith-inspired people. And recently when I was, about a week ago, I read somewhere, and I don't like to quote statistics without a reference, so I'm so glad that David said that this is it. I attribute it to you, but 50% of volunteers are typically faith-inspired people. So, again, thank you, David, for giving me that quote, because now you can attribute that to him. But that's something that I would...
Stole it from you. You told me earlier. That was your first assumption.
Government and its finest. But see, that's one of the things we're seeing in Central America. Another part that has been quite exemplary, and it's really kind of produced it's mitigated a loss of life and mitigated conflict in areas that we've been trying to work on very much as a government and USAID, has been in the Central African Republic. We have been working with the Catholics, with the Protestants, with the Muslims to come together and say, look, we need to mitigate this conflict, and we need to tell each individual constituency to say, this does not need to be a religious issue. This is something that we can work out through dialogue, conflict mitigation, mediation, so on and so forth. Well, the churches and the Muslim community over there do not have the infrastructure, as we would say here, to have, you know, social workers and get the message out there, if it were not for the volunteers. And these religious leaders have come here to the United States, have been working with the White House, with the Department of State, with USAID, with our specific office, and through their volunteers and through the people that are inspired by faith that work with them, have been able to start building bridges and lessening the violence that has been happening in CAR. And these two examples, I can honestly speak from firsthand experience, would not be possible without the work of faith-based organizations and the volunteers that they rely on, which we all know is the backbone of their structure.
Thanks. Let me jump to one of the hardest challenges. And James, why don't you handle this first, and anyone that would like to follow up. So many people, when I talk about faith-based volunteering, immediately assume that proselytizing is a piece of the work. And if not a piece of the work, it's somehow in the back of people's minds one of the reasons that they want to go to other countries and meet people. How do you manage that?
I think that's a common misconception. I think that people do adhere to that in many cases, but it's not been my experience. I just had my 20th anniversary at Catholic Volunteer Network and have met a lot of volunteers and volunteer alumni over the years in our programs. And my experience has not been at all that that's the primary focus is proselytization or evangelization. I mean, there are certain programs where that's more of an emphasis than others, of course, but to me, it's not really the focus. I think our volunteers are doing healthcare and education and social services, and yes, some of them are more involved than others in pastoral ministry, but I really think that our programs, the faith component is more one of motivation on the part of the volunteer, him or herself. It's not so much about influencing the others. In fact, most of our programs, it's more a notion of accompanying the people and learning from them as much as you're also teaching them or helping them. So it's not about changing people and trying to convert them to your way of thinking. And I think that, you know, there's probably reasons why people have that conception. I think part of it is probably past transgressions on the part of people who abuse this kind of thing. And I think more recently, the focus on kind of religious extremism, I think, has led to that notion as well. But it's not at all my perception. We have over 20,000 volunteers that serve every year with our 200-member programs. About 1,450 of them served internationally last year. And I've never heard any concern about that on the part of our programs.
If I can jump in, actually, it's one of the interesting distinctions we think about a lot at the Service Alliance. Is what drives somebody to serve. And if your faith drives you to serve, it can be just as worthwhile as a desire to pay back your student loans, as a desire to get a job, as something just simply idealistic inside you that makes you want to do this. So I think we sometimes mix up motivation with the service itself and whether or not that includes proselytization. The other thing I'd like to note is that a number, besides Repair the World and Catholic Volunteer Network, which are fantastic service here programs, best in the country, there are a number of others as well. We've got the Episcopal Service here, the Episcopal Service Corps, and their Young Adult Service Corps actually serves internationally. Lutheran Volunteer Corps, Avoda, Jesuit Volunteer Corps, which we've talked about already, and Young Adult Volunteers with the Presbyterian Church are just initial examples. And many of those and others actually receive AmeriCorps funding, and that a tenet of that is that you cannot proselytize with that, and or organizations don't. It's not a core tenet of what they do, actually. And so that's, I think, another critical thing for us to remember is that these public-private partnerships, which we've been talking about a lot today, include faith-based partnerships already, and they're very deeply ingrained in American society without those transgressions that I think people consider when they first think about faith-based organizations, but in reality, very rarely exist.
A while ago, I was in New York at the United Nations, and we were having a discussion, and I said faith-based organizations. And somebody corrected me, and they said, well, why don't you use faith-inspired? And it kind of really stuck with me because I said, well, yeah, that's true. There's many that are faith-inspired, and we have at USAID, we do a lot of public-private partnerships with businesses that are faith-inspired and that don't specifically prescribe to one faith. That said, we do work a lot with many faith-based organizations, and one of the misconceptions that sometimes I think at the beginning when President Bush is previous panelist said, give credit where credit is due. She was talking about PEPFAR. President Bush, in 2001, he created the White House Office of Faith-Based and Neighborhood Partnerships. And really, this office was to work with faith with religious leaders and faith-based organizations to better serve those in need. And I think at the beginning, there were a lot of questions of, okay, what exactly is the government going to provide these faith-based organizations? Obviously, none of the funding that we offer can go towards any type of religious activity, but the majority of the recipients that are faith-based organizations are coming at it from a faith-inspired, I don't want to say theology, but ideology, if you will, to better serve somebody else. And that's where we work. And so a lot of times, well, not a lot of times, but at the beginning of these offices, it was much kind of changing the hearts and minds of government employees, where they talked about the Establishment Clause and the separation of church and state, to say what we're going to do and the faith-based organizations that we work for are not going to be proselytizing because that is not allowable under the law. Right now, we count on faith-based organizations as primary partners, excellent implementing partners, and the relationship that they've had with USAID, and I think it's indicative of the fact that we've been working with them for such a long time, is we don't have this issue. Once in a while, we'll get one organization that's asking some questions, but they're relatively new, but then we walk them through the process, and we just ensure that they are familiar with the limitations of what they can do with government funding. But it does happen. In different governments, they say that faith-based organizations from the United States are out there to proselytize, and part of our work is essentially to educate them and just clarify the fact that any faith-based organization receiving U.S. government funding cannot proselytize, is not going to do that. And our partners are very, very, very good about not doing that as well.
I think that, I was just going to say, I think that the establishment of that Office for Faith-Based and Community Initiatives really has brought faith-based service into shine a greater light on it, and I think in a positive way. Mm-hmm. I think that people have often seen faith-based organizations or faith-based volunteers more in terms of the welfare kinds of welfare in the sense of helping people, but not so much from the social and economic development side, which we're talking about today. So I think that's a part that really needs a lot more work, and there's not a lot been written about that.
And definitely, and if you look at it historically, faith-based adherents have been really kind of the driving force in international development.
So I need to push on that. So when I ran AmeriCorps and a lot of service programs, and we were under pressure from the White House to identify really good faith-based service programs that we could be really proud of, and so we touted the ones that we had. But frankly, it was incredibly hard, and I would say we were not very successful. I think that. That there's a level of suspicion within government and within our peer review system that kept pushing the faith-based applicants out of the pool. There's huge suspicion among faith-based organizations for getting government support. And there's something within the service movement that has a sort of a progressive strand that is not terribly friendly with a lot of the faith-based organizations. And so, you know, I would say it's partly one of the reasons that in this room so few people raise their hand when I ask how many faith-based. So do you feel like you're really being more successful than we were?
Well, I think, you know, when CNCS was established in 1993, and, you know, at the beginning of that, and under your leadership, I guess you had to deal with the bigger obstacles of, you know, it's something new, it's something related to faith.
No, we had a lot of lawsuits.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you're answering now. But I think, so the White House Office of Faith-Based and Neighborhood Partnerships was created in January of 2001. A lot of people believe that was kind of a reaction to 9/11. But it actually predates 9/11 by 8 months. So President Bush created this office under an executive order 8 months before. Right? USAID's office was created on the 12th of December of 2002. So we have a long history, but I know from my predecessors that it was an uphill battle for them to work within U.S. government to say, look, we work with these faith-based organizations. We already are working with them. They are our partners on the ground, but more so in that sense of, like, you know, now this is getting something that's here to stay. Because we've had a longer track record, I honestly think at USAID, and because we work in, you know, in areas where there's deep poverty and development issues need to be addressed, And for the most part, it's the church, the mosque, the temple, whatever, that sometimes manages in parts that are, you know, not governable. And so they have to work with them because we work with our implementing partners. We work with local solutions. We work with the indigenous communities to do that. And many times those are the religious organizations, the faith-based people. So for our office, I know that I would consider that we are having success and it's not been that much of an uphill battle. But for other organizations, other offices, for instance, the Department of Justice, their faith-based and neighborhood partnership center there, the Department of Commerce, where we also have an office, the issue is a little bit not as it's a little bit more nuanced, and it's sometimes getting them on board. So it really depends. I know CNCS has been very, very successful in working with faith-based organizations, but that's because you've had a long track history with them, and your office has been in existence for quite some time. Same with ours. Right now, 2 years ago, Secretary Kerry established the Office of Religion and Global Affairs, headed by my good colleague, Sean Casey. And at the beginning, you know, there were many queries of how is there going to be a faith-based office or a religion office working in the State Department? Well, you know, in few words or less, people look to USAID and to the other offices that had been in existence prior to them as a way to say, this is how government can work with them. And we also have very strict rules about how we work and everything. I mean, if you ever suffer from insomnia, look at our website. There's a pretty big book that'll give you the instructions of, you know, how we can work with faith-based organizations and faith-based organizations can work with us.
Right. That rule book is why we at Repair right now are not a grantee, because it's hard.
Yeah. Let me, Ethan, maybe you can
answer first on this. I'd be really interested in Jim and Eduardo as well. When you hear how hard and important the 2030 goals are, and you hear from Diane how strong the corporate engagement is, and David's talking about the Building Bridges Coalition, and there's so much momentum, how critical would you say it is to have a different level of engagement among faith-based organizations and volunteers in order for us to actually meet the 2030 objective?
Well, I think it's critical. You said a different level of engagement, and I think that's an interesting way of phrasing that actually right now. I think it's critical not just for the SDGs, as we heard from Ahmed earlier. There is an enormous population of young people under the age of 35 around the world. We can't accomplish anything without them, number one. Number two, we can't accomplish much without faith-based organizations either, because in many communities across the country, they are the trusted entities on the ground. And we have to be very realistic about that when we think through that. I think also, though, all these institutions, faith-based government, the UN, all the types of international development work we do, these are institutions that have growing levels of distrust, actually, amongst young Americans. And I think one of the things that you guys actually need more than you may realize is us. You need young people to be able to actually change that distrust level and be able to come in and say, we need a different level of impact coming from faith-based organizations, coming from government, coming from these international development organizations. And that cannot be accomplished without young people at the table. And so I think that's really critical. The other thing, too, that I'll say when it comes to accomplishing a lot of the goals that we've heard about today is one of the things that the Service Year Alliance is so proud of when it comes to our partnership with the Building Bridges Coalition. So for those of you who are in the room, I really encourage you to think about working with Building Bridges and us as we think about what's necessary in order to certify organizations to have service year members here, Americans here in the United States serving abroad. We already have a series of criteria that's available for domestic organizations, but we're working on expanding that because we need to be part of the solutions that we're talking about, these 2030 goals. And so I'd encourage you guys to work with BBC to do that. I hope that you'll participate because we'd really like to have a more broadening of a tent, so to say, that I know we hear that phrase a lot, but we can't accomplish any of those without faith-based organizations, without young people, and without a broader tent that it takes through this partnership to create in order to accomplish those goals.
Yeah, I read a study from the University of California at San Diego that asked people what was their primary motivation for serving, and 84% said that it was to alleviate poverty, so it fits in very well with the sustainable development goals. And also, I think just the faith-based groups, whether it's Christian or Muslim or Jewish or whatever, I think, you know, so many of the values that transcend, that run across those different faiths really fit in so well with the goals, the dignity of the human person, the care of creation, the restoring justice, all those things are things that we naturally aspire to anyway. So I think they fit in very well with the 2030 goals.
Thank you.
Can I actually tie one thing back to that? I'm sorry if I jumped in on you. One of the things that you just said that it reminded me of when it comes to the goals is another sort of fusion between the way we see things changing in the faith-based space and the way we see things changing amongst young Americans. And a perfect example of that is the environment. We're seeing a really, a huge sort of sea change when it comes to evangelical Americans and the way they interact with with environmental change and the difference that they feel is critical both to themselves as people of faith and to the future of our nation and our world, and we see that being critical to young people as well. So there's a lot of intersections here where the way people of faith are interacting with development is also changing the same way that can impact these goals critically.
Kind of going back to the...
Before you go, the next thing I'm going to do is put it out to you while you're listening to Eduardo.
Going back to the 2050, to the SDGs, and, you know, when the Charter of the United Nations was created, was written, it says, we the people. Part of that, we the people, and that's been an integral part of the United Nations system, has been the role of civil society, and civil society including secular and faith-based organizations. I know the General Assembly resolution that was passed by Japan and Brazil, two countries, two missions that have a lot of influence that are not part of the Permanent Five, that was passed to integrate volunteerism into the Sustainable Development Goals 2030 agenda, had been because a lot of influence and a lot of lobbying from the UN Executive Committee, which has a great majority of them faith-based organizations. And these faith-based organizations sometimes, you know, most of the time when you associate faith-based organizations, you're preaching from the pulpit of, you know, ethics and more morality. And I know, for instance, Japan and Brazil, having colleagues at those missions, were quite persuaded by this and really see the importance of this. So this was done by faith-based organizations. This was done by faith-inspired people, or, you know, partly done by faith-inspired people. Many of them, which are volunteers, representing their organizations at the United Nations. So, quite important.
Questions? And if you don't come up with them, I'll ask you. Yeah. you've got a mic coming. Give us your name and organization.
My name is Jim Swiderski, and I worked for many years with a non-religious affiliated volunteer organization. As we worked abroad, almost, I don't know, maybe more than half of the local hosts that we had were faith-based organizations in those countries. Those were the groups that were involved in human and community development in those countries as opposed to the governments normally. And I was just wondering if that is your experience and if there's a way of sharing that experience more broadly in the United States, because it just seems to me we have a much greater separation between the two than I experienced working abroad.
Jim, do you want?
I think to a certain extent it is our experience. I think that in other countries where our volunteers are serving, it is true that there's a greater latitude and leeway for them to be involved in those kind of activities even more than the governmental structures. But it depends on where you are. We're in about 114 countries, so it's not that way everywhere, but certainly I could resonate with what you were saying.
Another question? Yes.
Hi, my name is Khurram, and I am an Atlas co-fellow from Pakistan, serving here with Creative Associates International in D.C. So my question to you all is that when it comes to faith-based organizations, it always comes to our mind that it's kind of an exclusive club for people who associate themselves with a certain religion or a certain sect. So when will these faith-based organizations be more inclusive to admit people or to provide an opportunity to people following all different kinds of faiths to be a part of them and to volunteer with them? Thank you.
I think that's a great question. I think our programs, it's true, they are faith-based in terms of their sponsorship, but many of them are very open to accepting volunteers who may be searching and exploring their faith. So it's not, I don't think you have to be at a certain level or a certain degree of faith. On the other hand, you know, there is a certain expectation that it is a faith-based community, so there are certain expectations. So probably somebody that didn't want to, for example, have community occasional prayer or wasn't comfortable with that kind of thing, probably that would not be the best program. But I would say that on the whole, our programs really do not are not that rigid in terms of expecting someone to be at a certain level of depth of faith. I think, you know, as long as there's an openness to explore, I don't know if you have other thoughts.
Forgive me if I said this earlier, but the the Lutheran Volunteer Corps actually is the most religiously diverse corps here in America. So there is sometimes an expectation that service with an organization will be one way, and it takes a leap of faith on the part of the person going to serve that they may have misconceptions themselves when walking into these experiences. And so I think that's just one thing to keep in mind, is that we don't often actually know the core tenets and values and experience of those people serving in those organizations until we hear from them in person. So I'd encourage anyone thinking about it to do a little bit of research up front and see if that's their your conceptions are actually what turns out to be the reality. But keep those statistics in mind that we have many organizations that are faith-based or inspired that engage people of all faiths and none with with a vast amount of regularity.
It's been I was at a meeting the other day, and we were talking about specifically the question that you brought up about, you know, if somebody fits into this faith and they don't in, you know, in what organizations. So somebody said, well, you know, interfaith-based organizations, IFBOs. And I said, no more acronyms. We don't need any more acronyms because that's something we have enough of. But say, for instance, you go to Caritas Internationalis in the Levant, a great majority of the people working there are Muslim, and that is a Catholic organization. And there's many organizations that, as we were talking about earlier, that are faith-inspired. So essentially, if you look at the basic tenets of the three Abrahamic faiths is, you know, oneness of humanity, do well for others, so on and so forth. So you could work with different organizations. I know Islamic Relief USA has people that are not Muslims. Caritas Catholic Relief Services has people that are not Catholic. World Vision has people from all over the place. So it's essentially looking for them and looking at these other organizations. My experience has been that organizations that are very strict in who participates in them typically have a religious component to the work that they do, all right? Whether that be proselytizing or engaging in some type of study or engaging in some type of service activity that is exclusive for the members. So if you're going to participate in that, as Yasmin said, you know, just make sure that it fits into the model that you're looking for participating in.
I don't also just want to note, as a way, I heard a lot of openness to the idea that faith-based organizations have a lot of inclusion, and certainly repaired us as well. But I also want to note that there's lots of other, there's fraternities that volunteer and that do overseas service, and in order to be part of that program, you got to be a member of the fraternity. Companies, when IBM sends its employees overseas to do volunteering, you got to be an IBM employee in order to be doing that kind of service. So the idea that every program has to be open to everybody doesn't actually on its face make a whole lot of sense. Yes, Steve, and then we'll sort of do an arc.
Hi, I'm Steve Culbertson from YSA Youth Service America. I would say just a comment and a question. The comment is that we work around the world, 125 countries with kids. The vast majority of them have their first experience in a faith-based, you know, Sunday school or at their temple, at their mosque, at their church. So faith is a really critical on-ramp for children to have their very first volunteering experience. Although that's juxtaposed against the fact that the fastest growing religion in the world is none of the above, right? So we've got a, you know, sort of an issue looking forward into the future. I would point out the Google study that was done last year, and I wanted to ask you about how you think this affects the faith-based community, because what Google discovered is that 49% of us are interested bystanders, their word, interested bystanders. They want to help, they want to contribute, but they're waiting to make a connection to who they are. And I would think faith would be a really, really critical bridge, that if the faith-based organizations could figure out how to build that bridge between faith and the, you know, the SDGs, let's say, that we could have an extraordinary outpouring, because that, you know, that enlightened self-interest of their faith, I would think, and I'm curious what you think, you know, could be that bridge that would make them no longer bystanders, but, you know, active players.
I think it's a good, Catholic Volunteer Network does a lot of recruitment on college campuses. Our main, about 70% of our volunteers are 21 to 25 years of age, so that's our primary outreach on college campuses. But I like what was said earlier in the panel is that, you know, they're early retirees or people that are retired, living longer, healthier lives, having more time to devote to volunteerism. We're seeing that number go up to the 55-plus year. But I like see what you said about tying it in with the 2030 SDGs because, you know, when we recruit volunteers, it's talking more about service in a general sense, but to really give them some specific things and to, you know, I doubt that very many people know what the 17 points are, the 169 targets are of the 2030 SDGs. So I really like that idea of having something clear to focus on to kind of connect them and find a niche where they might belong.
I think it's actually an opportunity for faith-based organizations and communities of faith in particular. It's not just an opportunity for development or organizations trying to make an impact. It's actually critical to faith communities. Faith communities are seeing I'm very defensive of them, but in reality, they're losing adherence, and that's because they have, and this is well known with our communities, but a lack of an ability to really change with the world as it changes and make themselves relevant to the young people who are walking out their doors. I'm not familiar with the Google study, but I would venture a guess that is not millennials. I think that's probably a much wider breadth of the American population. And I think that's another reason why I come back to young people is that many young people aren't interested bystanders. That doesn't resonate for us. You know, we've gotten up off our chairs. We're done. We're not bystanders right now. So I think it's really actually interesting to think about not only the opportunity for these organizations to make impacts, but for faith-based organizations to sort of grow with the people around them and make themselves relevant again to a growing number of young people who, although they are nuns and have no particular religious affiliation, still are highly spiritual. That's not included, actually, in the measurements that show them being less religious. And so I think there's another opportunity that we see there as well.
Can I just ask our Repair the World full-time fellows to quickly stand and wave? These guys, thank you for being here. These guys, they do their full-time service, Steve, doing what you talked about, which is basically connecting the community and millennials with that their core value of wanting to make the world better and doing it through the Jewish lens.
Maybe because in the office where I work in and, what my portfolio is, I don't see that, and I don't, and just based off my experience, I wouldn't agree with that. I see a growing trend of people volunteering with faith-based organizations. I see the importance of faith-based organizations and the volunteers have in government. As I said, in 2001, we started with one, the White House Office of Faith-Based and Neighborhood Partnerships, and now we have 13, 11 of which focus on domestic issues, 2 of which focus internationally. Next year is Director Pastor Raditz from the Peace Corps. The Peace Corps has a faith-based initiative that hopefully next year will become solidified as a faith-based center. So then we'll have 14, okay? We see this kind of office of civil society engagement towards faith-based organizations being replicated throughout, not only in the United States governments, as I said, with the Peace Corps, but throughout other international organizations and other governments. The World Bank, just right down the street, they have their faith-based initiative. Right, started up about a year and a half ago, they're growing. The United Nations, the UN, UNFPA Population Fund, has an interagency task force on religion and development, which at some point in time, I foresee, is going to evolve into an office. And maybe Anwar spoke about that. I don't know if she did or not, but I really see this being an evolution because of the presence of faith-based organizations within the United States, within the UN nation systems, both at the Secretariat and the Economic and Social Council. Germany, GMZ, the development agency for Germany, actually has created an office for that as well. So this is something that's growing. This is something where we get queries about how does it work? How does it work? How has it worked in the United States? What services do we provide? How can we help them? Because this is something that people are wanting to replicate. And many times, our office, particularly the Center for Faith-Based and Community Initiatives, seems to get the highest amount of internship applications based on the interest of religion, development, and diplomacy. So, you know, diplomacy and development, I mean, they can do that at the State Department or at various offices at USAID, but we get them specifically, and we have the highest amounts because religion is in there. Whether or not they're, you know, adherence to specific faith or not, that's the topic of interest to them. So
we have about 10 minutes. So I was hoping to do is there's a cluster of questions over there. I think there was one over there. And then we'll hear them all at once, and then we'll answer and close out.
Hi, my name is Kim Smolik. I'm the executive director of Franciscan Mission Service, which is a Catholic faith-based full-time service organization. I've been doing this work for about 12 years. And I'm really interested in highlighting what faith-based service organizations do that is not apologetic, but actually adds value to this movement. I feel like sometimes in this space, we're often doing apologetics. So I just want to highlight a question that David had raised to the panel about the leaning of this movement of service tends to be more towards the progressive, but the faith-based environment might be a little bit not in that space. And what I've noticed over the years is that the environment that I'm in is that we do attract people both, let's just say, on the right and the left that come to our organization. The nature of being a faith-based organization is the holistic approach we take, which Jim spoke to, is that the volunteers live in community, they engage in meals together, they engage in social analysis and reflection, they pray together, and we bring together people on the right and the left that are with each other for at least a year, if not more. So what's happening there is because they come to know each other face to face, they begin to listen to each other in a way that's different, in a space where the right and the left are rarely coming together. So I say service is the meeting point, at least in the Catholic Church, where both the right and the left agree this is how we get things done together. And so I see the faith-based movement in volunteerism as being a place that's really good at bringing sort of both sides of the aisle together for this next generation of leaders to be able to listen and dialogue and value each other. So my question is, one, have you also seen that? Are you leveraging that? And also, what are you doing, or what other areas do you see faith-based volunteerism having something different to offer, or not different, but even what's the value add without just it being apologetic?
Hi, my name is Rachel, and I'm working with the World Bank Faith-Based Initiative. And I'm just wondering, in your experiences, so your distinct experiences and unique experiences, what are the ways that you've seen SDGs or faith-based organizations engage with the SDGs? And I guess, what are the broader ways that they can actually really add? Because we see that they have a huge contribution potential, and a lot of the problem comes in communicating to them what the SDGs are, just because the SDGs aren't too well known. And we know that they have a huge potential in advocacy, in education, and we've heard a lot about volunteerism, but do you have any other distinct or unique aspects that may not be so obvious as to how they can add to that? Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ariel Arguez, an Archer Fellow with the Sabin Vaccine Institute, and my question is actually very similar. You mentioned I appreciated the distinction between faith-inspired and faith-based. I wanted to see more your ideas and where you see perspective for those actually faith-based organizations that are more, have the evangelical part of their ministry, how they do their service, have that as an integral part of who they are, seeing how you see you can still leverage those relationships, because in many cases, those organizations are deep-rooted into different communities around the world. So I just really wanted to hear your thoughts.
Take one more question, and then if everyone could wrap up.
Hi, my name is Joyce Friedenberg, and I'm with USAID. I have a completely disconnected sort of question, more on the operations side. I was a volunteer with the Jesuit Volunteer Corps, and I ran into the issue, this was, 20 years ago, coming back from my volunteer experience and not having the same sort of benefits that the Peace Corps volunteers had. And I'm wondering if the faith-based organizations have taken on that battle at all in the last 20 years since I've been disconnected from it.
I'll start, or you want to start since you have so many. two quick things. I'll just address two of them quickly because I know some of my colleagues are better equipped to answer a couple more. Kim's question highlighting faith-based service years and how they can come from a posture of not being apologetic any longer for a very series of reasons. I really celebrate your question. I think that's a great one. I think two different things. Number one, the pride of young people that I see in serving in those organizations is almost going, I hope the demographic problem will no longer be there. I see that pride in young people serving in organizations like many I mentioned earlier, and I hope that you are fostering that within your communities to say that this is something that we are doing that is part of a movement that you see happening around America. And that's one of my jobs at the Service Year Alliance, is ensuring that you feel that way, that you are no longer apologetic for your service in a faith-based core, and rather you are part of, to use this phrase one more time today, a sea change that's happening across America, regardless of intention. And so that's the first critical thing I want to say. The second is the value add when it comes to faith-based organizations. Again, I'm speak from a perspective of most familiarity with service year organizations, but there's two critical things I want to call out for those of you that aren't very familiar with them in the room. The first is an ability to foster community within faith-based service year organizations that I've seen to be almost unparalleled. I've seen some on the ground in Senegal, I've seen Peace Corps workers have a similar sort of experience. But other than that, it's really unique to faith-based organizations, and it's something young people these days are really struggling for as we grow up, is a sense of community with other people that continue to have these same questions that we do. And so I hope young people will start to turn to faith-based organizations, and regardless if they decide to join one that is of one community or one that is welcoming to people of all different faiths or none together, to foster that sense of community, I think it's critical. I also think it's critical to nation building as Americans. I think it's something you mentioned, sort of an ability for people to come from both the left and the right to serve together and to have a deeper sense of empathy that we know from every statistic we've seen is really lacking in America today. I feel that same way about service years outside of faith-based organizations. I see it amongst people who have served in civilian capacity and people who have served in a military capacity. Those two groups of people have something unique to bond them together as either a Peace Corps volunteer or a JVC member internationally. You have a certain deeper sense of empathy and respect for someone who served in the military because they have gone through a similar level of hardship as you. And I see that coming the opposite way from members of the military as well. I think it's critical to our nation moving forward that we have those experiences within faith-based organizations and outside. And that deeper level of trust that we're going to develop that we don't have right now is part of that demographic shift that I see happening if we do this correctly. The only other thing I'd say quickly to your point about JVC is that I really hope, and we're seeing change like that happen all the time, but it takes our organizations collectively standing up and saying that we need to look out for each other in this system. And regardless of whether you're JVC or Peace Corps, you need a certain level of structures around you when you come home to make sure you're better able to reintegrate. Vanessa was talking about student loans. Having a coalition of people, I hope everyone in this room links up with the Service Year Alliance after this, because that's one of the things we're trying to provide, is a broader tent that can advocate for that.
Thank you for answering so many of those questions. And Eduardo and Jim, we've got like 35, 40 seconds.
Okay, cool. So I'll try to address this very quickly. No worries. Take the words right out of my mouth. Real quick, about FBOs being apologetic, I wouldn't be. USAID, and my colleague could correct me if I'm wrong, we see faith-based organizations as integral implementing partners, and we rely on you quite often, and I know the Obama administration has been very keen about promoting faith-based organizations and participations in the work that we do, both internationally and domestically. To my colleague from the World Bank, FBOs working with SDGs, I know a lot of it is communicating, and a lot of FBOs sometimes work independently. You know very well, as all people in government do, that right now we're working with the Joint Learning Initiative, post-World Humanitarian Summit on the PARD, which the acronym escapes me right now, but it's essentially kind of a blueprint of how faith-based organizations can all work together, leverage their strengths, their knowledge, and their numbers to be able to be fruitful and big implementing partners in the SDGs 2030 Development Agenda. FPOs and evangelical inspired leverage. I didn't quite get the question, but what I could tell you is we rely heavily on faith-based organizations from a particular faith to address issues with that particular community. There are many places in El Salvador I would not have been able to go. USAID would not have been able to go. The Salvadorian government would not have been able to enter if it weren't for the faith-based organizations and the evangelical churches that were really kind of the respect of that area in those places. So thank you for that. And you know, just play to your strengths, because that is invaluable. That's something government and many organizations don't have.
We need to...
Well, I would just say to Kim's question about the more progressive and perhaps more conservative, I do believe that service really is a meeting point to bring people together. And we see that with young adults coming from all stripes these days, and most of our volunteers are young adults. And so I can really relate to that, and I've heard that actually from other programs as well. So I think that service can bring people together, not just the people we serve, but the volunteers themselves.
Well, you've brought us together today. Please thank our great panel.